大家好，谢谢大家的一起来参加今天下午的活动。那我是阮庆月，那我旁边是我们一起共同策展人那个 Thomas 曾庆豪。啊，我们两个会今天下午担任那个主持。那第一场是请藤森昭信老师跟 Sanhassel 跟我们谈第一个主题，就是我们今天的第一个主题是叫城市的传统。那主要是想就是从像藤森老师他从街道这个角度来重新思考现代城市的到底是什么样的一个位置点。那 Sam 是长期关注亚洲城市，尤其对台北有很多的研究跟他的了解，所以我们也希望 Sam 从他的角度告诉我们一些关于他对东亚城市此刻的一些状态的一些说明。那我们可能这个进行的方式是我们会先请藤森老师跟Sam 各先用15分钟就这个主题跟大家做个说明，然后后面的时间带来的20分钟、25分钟，我们会做一个很快速的一个交谈。那我们就开始，可能就麻烦藤森老师，是不是要先开始跟我们做个差不多15分钟的一个说明？
これはル・コルビジェの理想をそのままブラジルの建築家たちが実現したもので、大変素晴らしい作りですから現在世界遺産に指定されておりますけれども、そこを見に行ったんです。で、最初の日は本当に感動しました。本当にこう人の歩くところとそれから車というのは、一日歩いていてもほとんどこう車を感じずに非常に広大な都市を歩くことができました。それから住宅地もこう相当自由に人が歩くんですけれども、全然コルビジェのピロティという作り方でできてますから、こう自由に歩いて住んでいる人の住んでいるところと交差しないんですね。大変感動しまして、もう一度ちゃんと見てみようと思って翌日行ったんですけども、全く歩く気がしなかった。なぜかっていうと、一日見ればもう十分なんです。完全にコルビジェの理想通りに作られて、理想通りに維持されております。ですから1日歩くのはもう十分で、2日行っても全くどこ行っても同じものがあるだけだっていうことに気づいた。例えば住宅地があります。こう例えば1000人なら1000人単位でこうまとまってあるんですが、それごとに商店街っていうのがあります。その商店街も全部一種類ずつのお店がある。レストラン、それから洗濯、それから写真屋さん、それから喫茶店、それから雑貨屋さん、食料品屋さん、そういうのがずっとこうある単位ごとにあるだけなんで、一つのところに行くと隣へ行っても全く同じものがある。ですから一個だけ行けばいい。それで理想的な都市かもしれないけども、とにかく一日で飽きるんですよね。美人は2日で慣れるって言いますけども、本当にそういう感じですね。最初はいいんだけど2日3日すると、僕ブラジルはもう一日でよかったんですが、なぜそういうことが起きるか、それはことをずっと考えるわけです。そうすると分かるのがですね、実はそのブラジリアっていうのは作られてからもう40年くらいしますけれども、その40年間止まったままなんです。当時のままに維持されています。特に世界遺産になってますから、もう変えることはできないんです。要するに、で普通の人たちがですね、普通都市というのは 人がまだ住宅地というのはですね、できたときは、あとですね、そこで人がいろんなことをやります。こう手を入れたり、あるいはこうちょっと直したり、まあそういうことでだんだんだんだんこう変わっていくんですよね。でも全然そういう変わることが許されてない都市なんです。これはどういうことかっていうと、実は40年経ってもできた時と同じっていうことは40年間の歴史がそこには刻まれていないっていうことなんです。で、歴史が刻まれていないっていうことは別の言い方をすれば時間がそこにはちゃんと建築や都市に流れてこなかったっていうことです。それで非常にやっぱ大きな問題だと思いました。ということはですね、それで考えたんですけども、20世紀の建築理論、これは中心になってグロピウスとかコルビジェたち、あるいはそのグループが作り上げたものですけれども、20世紀の建築理論、それは現在の台北や現在の日本や世界の近代的な都市というのは全て20世紀の建築理論に従って都市と建築が作られているわけですけれども、その建築理論の中にですね、歴史とか時間っていうのが入ってないんです。でむしろ歴史というのについてはですね、非常に批判的で、20世紀建築を作った人たちはですね、歴史を否定して、それ前のこうずっと自分たちがギリシャとかローマからずっと続く歴史があるわけですけれども、そういうものをスタイルを非常にこれはもう20世紀にはふさわしくないということで否定して、自分たちの建築をゼロから作り上げたわけです。おそらくその中でですね、彼らの理論の中に時間とか歴史っていうものが欠けてしまったんです。その結果こういう鉄とガラスとコンクリートの街が作られ、それは当然のようにそこに人々が働きかけたり、あるいはいろんなことをしながら少しずつ都市が変わっていくっていう、そういう時間が欠けてしまったわけです。でもう一つですね、20世紀の建築理論っていうのがですね、触れなかった問題がある。これは20世紀の建築理論は時間とか歴史、特に歴史については非常に批判したわけです。歴史的な蓄積っていうのはいらないんだ。自分たちはそういうものとは関係ない。で、彼らのそういう理論のですね、背景にあったのは20世紀が科学と技術の時代であるっていう、非常にその科学と技術っていうのはですね、古いとか歴史を帯びてるっていうことには意味がありません。なぜなら古いものほど間違ってますからです。現代のものが一番いいっていうのが科学と技術の考えですけれども、それに従って彼らは自分たちの建築理論を作りましたから、どうしてもその歴史とか時間というのを否定的に扱ったわけです。で、自然についてはですね、彼らはさすがに自然を否定しているような言葉は一つも述べておりません。ただですね、自然については触れた言葉がないんです。彼らはさまざまな科学の問題とか技術の問題とか生産の問題とか、そういうものを扱いますけれども、自然、木とか川とか緑っていうについては触れないんです。どうすべきであるとか。で、唯一触れたのがコルビジェでございまして、ピロティというコルビジェが5つの20世紀建築の原則というのを出します。その2番目がですね、ピロティっていうもので、こう上に上げて、そこに下を全部交通のために使うと、柱で持ち上げて、それで そこで失われた緑を屋上に持ってくる、そのピロティというのをですね、から2番目に屋上庭園ですけども、屋上庭園というのを2番目に彼は言います。ピロティが1番目、2番目が屋上庭園ですけども、 でコルビジェはですね初期の作品早い時期に屋上庭園をやってみたんです。ちっちゃな住宅で。でももうそれっきりで二度とやらないんですね。でやりますけども非常にこう目立たないようにしかやらないっていうのは彼はやってみて、うまくいかないってことを、まあ、気づいたんだと思いますけれども、で以降コルビジェだけがその屋上庭園っていう提案をしたんですけども、それの以外の人たちはですね自然をどう扱うかっていうことは全然触れなかったんですよね。その結果ですね20世紀建築っていうのは2つの大きな欠落を持ったんです。一つは歴史と時間ですね。でもう一つは自然。自然については否定したわけではないけど、どう扱うかっていうことをに触れなかったんですね。それでここにテーマである道というのは何かっていうことです。で道というのはですね、まあ、ここでいう道は車が通る道ではなくて人の通る道ですけども、人がですね通りを通るときに何が楽しみかっていうと、まあ、いろんな楽しみがあるけど、一つはですねそこのまあ緑ですよね。緑の自然こう見えたりする、あるいはこう街路樹が見えたり、場合によると庭が見えたり、いろんな緑があります。もう一つはですねこう建物の持っているあるこう歴史を帯びた雰囲気です。こう僕らがこう歩いていて何かこう人の気配があったり、何かこう人がそこに働きかけた跡がある。例えばそうここにビラが貼ってある、で何かこう訴えるビラが貼ってある。例えば私の家の猫がいなくなりましたけど探してくださいと、そういうのを見るととてもこう人間的な感じがします。ですから我々は実はその町を歩く時の非常に大きな楽しみとして、そこの町に蓄積されてきた歴史というものがあるわけです。で、まあ、そこの町の中にある自然という、でこれがおそらく我々が町をこう通りをストリートを歩く時の大きな喜びなんです。ところがそういうストリートを歩く時の大きな喜びについてですね、実はその20世紀の建築理論っていうのは、まあ、触れなかったわけです。で、まあ、20世紀以降の、まあ、新しい建築理論はそれについて、まあ、いろんな問題を提案しているわけですけども、20世紀建築が触れなかった時間の問題、歴史の問題、それから自然の問題、これがおそらく私はですね21世紀の新しいテーマではないかという、まあ、気持ちがしております。
谢谢陈森教授。当然陈森教授的路上观察术我虽然已经是二三十年前，但是继续的而且越来越强大的影响，我相信台湾是深受影响，也会影响到更大的面向。那下一位我们请那个San Hesso， 他事实上他对台北也做了很多研究，出版过一本书叫《Taipei Oppression》，然后他也是常常他的角度也是从比较底层，从街道来观看一个城市，所以我们请 San 来跟我们分享一下他的看法。
It's always very risky to talk about Taipei in Taipei, and also to talk after Fujimori's talk. So I'm a bit nervous this experience. I'm going to pick up on a couple of points that really have come from the last, the exhibition upstairs and a few of the comments that were made. And I really wanted to touch on Director Huang's remarks that the shift now needs to be made from looking to the West in the past to the West now looking at the East and to what we are doing. And this is what I'll do in this lecture, and that maybe alleviates some of the pressure that I'm the only one on the panel who's not from East Asia. Thus, I've inverted the street of learning and the streets from the exhibition to seven lessons I've learned from the streets of Taipei. So my contributions to the, my acknowledgement to the curators of this wonderful exhibition. It is my first, the lesson I've learned. And it's really the role of the expert, but also the celebration of everyday life. And through my experience in Asia, and perhaps over the 15 years, I make very strange collections of observations. And these are automatic photographs I take in. These are automatic photographs I take in market stalls, in Asian markets. And many of these here are from Seoul and Taipei. And I've been impressed in the innovation in displaying, or what I consider stacking, of goods, which makes me realize that everyone is a designer or has that capacity. Everyone is an architect, to misquote Joseph Beuys. And this has raised two important questions to me over the years. If that is the case, how and what should an architect be doing in this culture? And how can we engage these citizens, these innovators, in the design of our cities in a meaningful way? And I think Taipei encourages some of that activity. My specific expertise was called into question when I participated in a 3-month workshop in Taipei many years ago, and Taipei Operations that Ron cited was the result of this collaboration between KCB, Ron, Shi-Tin, and me, and between Tam Kang and RMIT universities. The problem was that I had little local knowledge and was worried about the stereotypes my students and I would bring to this new environment for us, with words like ad hoc, chaotic, rapidly developing being the terminology that was phrased in the West about the Asian city. And I was convinced upon arrival that there were hidden structures in place, and all we needed to use or to find were the tools to discover them. And basically, the first move was the decision to look carefully, which I now realize is perhaps the most important tool that an architect or a designer has. And it seems so obvious, but it's terribly underrated. not many of us do that. So we took to the streets. We were rigorously specific in terms of time and place. We made lists. We made catalogs. We made numbers. And through this study, we were able to trust the reality, the facts of everyday life, and build from there without imposing any hidden logic. So for instance, the device of walking through the city, through the streets of 4 walks, starts, as Mr. Fujimori says, with a tree and has a lot of food in the middle with 7-Eleven at the end, which proves to me that we're in Taipei. And another device is to compare things to what we already know. So this is a comparison between, I suppose, Melbourne's sort of exciting street filled with cafes on the right, that's our chaotic street, and a typical streetscape in Taipei. So that's about looking. I think continuing the looking, we realize that by this close observation, that there are a number of stories that can be told in a city. And Taipei is a great city in that regard. So again, almost a misquote of Italo Calvino, I think the good cities are capable of an infinite number of narratives. So we use the technique of the urban diary, and I realize that one of these photos is in your exhibition, Mr. Furujami, upstairs, of the Taipei post boxes. So we looked at everyday objects to see if we could shift scales and uncover some other of these narratives or new ways of seeing cities. So from standing in one place and looking at one post box to see the use over time, to moving through the city, and then remapping a very particular view or narrative of the city, which might be the postman's routes, which differs from other narratives and other routes through the cities. The drawings of diaries of an original and parallel diaries of original and pirated Louis Vuitton handbag, as you can see there, almost identical in appearance, and a small object, But it does create two different maps of the world in terms of where they're produced and two totally different economic models. But I think what is most poetic in this discovery and the scale of the city is to actually see 6 minutes of the original on the left in the Sogo department store and 6 minutes on the right in the streets of Taipei laid out on a blanket. And I think through these very careful studies, we can actually tell a lot about how the city is lived. My favorite is the diary of the local garbage truck, which heralds a weekly weekly arrival in, to the rubbish collection by playing a digitized version of Für Elise by Beethoven. I'm not sure if this still happens, but it did at the time. And we gathered to dispose our garbage and recycling. And I think the interesting thing about these urban narratives is that there are many different points of view or responses to that. I thought it was an incredibly romantic gathering at the village square, where the authors of the piece actually thought it was a nuisance and needed to be fixed and addressed. So much like my favorite outing to eat clams in Liaoning Night Market, that might not appeal to those who hang out in Xinyi, but it's wonderful that cities afford those two different types of experiences in its streets. So a good city, which Taipei is, sustains and generates all these differing narratives. The fourth lesson I've learned is about the city is lived and the city is, rather than the city is built. And I think that that's really indicative of many Asian cities. And it's really taught me that that's what our city should be and that's what our streets should be. The lines are blurred between inside and outside and public and private. There's physical blurring of buildings and boundaries in Taipei. And this expression of the city of lived, as lived in these examples, makes me question the validity of the conventional maps and drawings that architects and designers use. And I worry that these form the base of too many built proposals, where in fact maybe we need to redraw the city to actually express the phenomena that exists in order to make our marks. We need to make more accurate maps. The urban field takes on one of the issues in the exhibition upstairs and maybe touches on some of Fujimori's points. Taipei has enabled me to perceive of a city as a landscape with a complex set of systems as opposed to a collection of buildings, which is another way or perhaps conventional way of seeing the city. And I think a city, a good city, is best seen over the long term, and I'm not talking necessarily in terms of history, but in a process of growth and decay, much like how a landscape operates. And these diagrams of the Da'an district show the sort of the growth and decay of the city as designed or authorized and then swollen with the illegal structures that have been built over the years. So it's quite remarkable. I'll do that again. That's not that many times. And then if we look at a detail, we see that a really strong hierarchy of small laneways, alleys, and streets, a hierarchy, that hidden order, one of the hidden orders I was trying to find, but then built up over time by a series of accretions, which I think makes a good city, where an individual is able to make its mark, whether it be by posters and by loggings or by actually expanding the scale of the city itself. I think the Taipei, again looking at these streets, reveals a highly ordered and not a chaotic set of structures. And if you can see on the left, the large boulevards have different height buildings and the smaller streets and laneways, but they can each be attributed in a sense without zoning to scales that are appropriate for the car, appropriate for the motorcycle, and appropriate for the present pedestrian. And I think that these boundaries are very interesting to see the city again is used, or reflecting how it's used, rather than its zone. And in my opinion, there's nothing that kills a city more than making pedestrianized streets. It strips all the character out of it. So you can see in these examples that a car would be mad to try to get down there, and yet other scales are more appropriate. So there's a self-ordering system that I think in terms of this organic growth that I see the city as landscape that actually happens in terms of respect of how it's used and how these accretions over time happen. And I find this much more desirable to those restrictions imposed by planning. And I think you can see that conclusion here of a fast and slow and small and still of those sorts of then characters that imbued into this grain. This is a more current preoccupation of mine, and some of the contributors to a workshop I did last year in Tamkang are here in the audience. And perhaps my tone now shifts from that of a sort of admiring and learning Westerner to one who is giving a warning. I think East Asian cities, and in particular Taipei, is a working city. You can still buy things, you can still get things made, and I love that about it. I go to Hua Yin Street and find in 10 minutes goods that I've given up after 6 months in looking for in Melbourne, and I don't even speak Chinese. New York, in my lifetime, and I was born there, has pushed all of its light industry to the periphery. When architects moved into the lofts and raised all the property values, those goods and services have now ostensibly disappeared. And I see that potentially happening in Luzhou, or soon happening in Luzhou in Taipei, I apologize for my pronunciation, with the advent of the MRT arriving to the district and thus the subsequent real estate values going up. And then the markets along the new, the gentrified Cheung Yichon stream in Seoul, where all of a sudden that gentrification again means this vibrant aspect of the city and the urban grain disappears. I hope that this doesn't become just documentation, archival documentation or set of all the warehouses in Luzhou, and we documented all 500 of them, and not a record of the social and economic loss, which will be major to the city of Taipei, in my opinion. My last point is really, I suppose, talking about some of the things that are applied in not necessarily a philosophical sense of modernism, but in the contemporary city, Western city, that I think are being directly taken from East Asia. Many architects and urban designers in Australia and Europe are looking very carefully at Asia for models for the contemporary city. The Dutch are infilling the anonymous landscapes and car parks around their high-rise developments, their housing developments. But unfortunately, the developments that they're now filling in are looking remarkably like those in, that are being built now in Xinyi and approved elsewhere in Taipei. They're doing this in order to create a street life, which they consider essential to a better scale of social space. The new and environmentally sustainable housing models in Australia are the four-story walk-ups with an active street life, shops below, and these models abound in Taipei, and I'm not sure how well they're appreciated here. Sydney is building a laneway system in new developments in order to promote an informal occupation of bar and cafe culture, which again emulates some of those models in Asia. So I suppose my response to a modern Taipei is that I think you have most of your answers already in the city, and I think you need to look. And I think a lot of the architects and practitioners and artists upstairs have been looking very carefully. There are two that resonate with me and continue to as a really ideal urban model. From what was a typical condition of a street cafe on Yang Kang Street encroaching on the adjoining block illegally, to extraordinary moments in the 24-hour stakeout. I don't know if this has a pointer. Oh yeah, sorry. and you look at peak hour, and I became intrigued by this gap and wondered what that was. And that gap was when the terribly popular ice cream place hired a bouncer to clear the facade of the adjoining building next door, the Japanese restaurant, so not to obstruct his trade. And I think that that shows an incredibly desirable possibility of grassroots negotiation rather than from above planning. And that's possible in this city. The second and final image in respect of planning is one of my favorite drawings of all time, which is produced by the Taipei City Council. And in it, the hatch buildings are the legal buildings, and the cross-hatch buildings are the illegal buildings. And I think this shows an ideal mix of the sort of top-down planning, and the fact that the planners drew this, so it's scales of 1 to 1,000, and the bottom-up living of the city, 1 to 1 in individual scale. And these are all reconciled in one drawing. I think this becomes a metaphor and a possibility for action into reconciling these two scales and types of activities. When I asked the director of urban design how could he draw this map or condone it, showing the illegal, he said that these were all the restaurants and cafes and street vendors in Taipei, and that formed the spirit of Taipei. And I say, long live the spirit of Taipei.
Send 的这个说明啊，那我们在就是我们再来接下来这个阶段时，我们可能会先由 Thomas 跟我各提一个问题，请教两位教授，然后我们会暂时就立刻开放给现场的朋友，看有人要直接问题，所以我们两个人提一轮问题后，就会开放给现场。那现场看发问的情形，我们会再回来做结论。那可能 Thomas 就先开始。
And thank you, Juan, and thank you very much for Fujimori Sensei and Professor Hassel for this afternoon's presentation. One of my questions that comes in the relationship of ideal city also is the ideal village, because from the point of view, looking at a city, it's actually recorded of many, many records of times across. So relationship how Fujimori Sensei has mentioned that history is developed, has gotten away from nature, and contemporary city has gotten away from the history. The question is that if science and technology is a giving clue, introduce us as materials such as iron and glass, which tightly seal us from the inside and outside, what are some of the questions that comes in? How do we bring the scale of inside to outside back to the streets again? So the question that also comes from Professor Fujimori Sensei is the question that how are we making the ideal cities in a place where the ideal city only has one perspective? And what are the multiple perspectives that you foresee as a yourself as a historian, later to become an architect, and your work start to become work itself to place itself into the history of architecture? Could you maybe expand a little bit?
理想的な都市ということは考えたことがあるんですけど、空想、ですね、非常に割と早い段階でその考えが行き詰まったんです。これはですね、どういうふうにして行き詰まったかというと、20世紀の都市を作っている、一つの原理ですが、それはコルビジェの言葉で言うと鉄とガラスとコンクリートで作ったものですけれども、それとですね、私が本質的に好む自然とかですね、時間っていう、この2つをどういうふうにこう融合させるか、あるいはこう一致させるかっていうテーマは、この40年間くらい私の大きなテーマでした。でも真面目に考えれば考えるほどこの2つは 20世紀的な原理と20世紀が忘れてきた原理こうどんどん離れていくっていう実感がものすごくあるんです。だからその結果ほとんどもう現実を無視するしかないというような非常にそういう点ではなんか 夢のない状態になっています。それとかねもう一つ日本の を代表する建築家で磯崎新っていう方がいます、まあ、僕らの先輩です。磯崎さんとつい最近いろいろ話していたんですが、その僕らが絵を描いたりですね演劇を作ったり、まあ、建築をデザインしたり、まあ、いろんな表現活動をします。その表現活動っていうのがまあそれは自由な表現活動をとしてやってるんですけども、どんどんどんどん一種のこう経済の原理に取り込まれていくわけです。我々が始めた20年前に始めた路上観察というのも我々早い段階で経済活動の中にこう取り込まれていくっていうのがよく分かったんですね。それで結局そういう中でどんどんどん、まあ、いわば経済というのがいろんなものをこうコントロールし支配していく中で我々の一体自由とは 何なのかっていう話を磯崎さんとしたんですよ。で磯崎さんがですねこうに言われたんですよね。最後の自由は半分気が狂ったような状態の中にしかない、正常な心や表現の中にはすでに自由はないと自分は今思っている。で、半分狂ったような仕事として唯一あるのが芸術だっていうことをおっしゃった。だからその感じは僕も強く分かりまして、本当にこう真面目に考えるとですね、ほとんどこう理想というのがなくて、でだから実際には僕はですねもうそれでは辛いので、時々空想的な都市の計画を、まあ、提案したりしております。
曾老师的这个回答，那我也提一个问题啊，请教那个 Sam Hazard 啊，当然我跟 Sam 其实是老朋友，已经认识很久了啊，我也很清楚知道 Sam 到现在的人生，我先不要说他几岁啊，其中有三分之一是在纽约过的，三分之一在伦敦，三分之一在墨尔本 ，right？ Yeah. 然后，所以他事实上居住过三个，其实是。距离相当远的三个城市都住了很久，可这中间他花了非常多时间在亚洲的城市之间移动。那我其实，所以我觉得 Sam 其实对西方、欧洲、美洲的城市或是澳洲城市都有很深入了解，可是他同时也对亚洲城市有相当深入了解。那我会有点好奇，就是 Sam 怎么看他，当然现在告诉我们了两边一些比较了，那我比较好奇也是同样对于未来的眺望，就是 Sam 会怎么认为东亚的城市在未来这个世纪会形成什么样子，以及它会跟西方欧洲的城市、美国的城市有越来越大的差异吗？
I think that's a good question and one that worries me a lot, especially about Taipei.I lived in London between the 70s and 90s, and there was a very low, there was not any money to build. So it avoided all of those horrible 70s buildings and postmodernism. And I thought, isn't that delightful? But as soon as they got money again, they built all of that stuff that the rest of the world had decided was terrible.So I worry, and from the experience that I've seen, that you need to go through those phases. And I find that worrying. I really am worried about some things happening in Taipei and that erasure that we see in a lot of East Asian cities. And I'm almost sort of grateful that there's not enough money here, like in China, to eradicate it all too quickly and too fast. And I think it would be really wonderful if there was a way to bypass some of those mistakes. So I think it's really interesting now that there is a growing, and this is over the past 10, 15, maybe 20 years, that I've noted that Europeans and Australians and English and are all, and I'm not so sure about the Americans, are all really looking and intrigued by the Asian model to deal with problems that the historic cities in the West have no answers to, such as how do you design the airport strip? How do you get to the airport in terms of European models? So I find that really reassuring, and I think that's why I find a show like this so important, that it is focusing on East Asians looking at the future and not taking applying the Western models anymore, and really looking quite hard to see what are the models that exist here. Does that answer your question?
Pretty much. 我们先这边终止，我们先开放，看有没有，我相信在座有更多有趣的问题，就我们先开放，有没有人要提问，在这时候，不用客气，就是两位老师都在台上，Thomas 你要准备好下一个问题，要是没有人举手的话，如果要提问的话，我们座位旁边有那个麦克风。
对，有没有人要提问？座位旁边有麦克风。对，我应该找到，结果，王馆长找不到他那个管理的那个麦克风。<笑>就是在这个展览里面。 台湾有就是有邀请了两个台湾非常非常年轻的艺术家，就是他们的那个，他们的作品是建筑，我们一般想象就是说它应该是很坚固的墙面去界定的，可是其中一个它是用完全。 这个很奇怪的那个弯曲的，而且穿透过墙面，而且那个墙壁已经变成不但有破洞，而且变成像云一样可以左右互相穿透的，这是一个例子。第二个例子是那个柱子变成几乎透明的，而且我记得非常清楚，那位艺术家说，这里面重点不是那东西，而是只要有人进去之后，人形成的那个关系，那个时候。 那个出来了，还有另外的话就是那个日本的那哪位艺术家，就是做的那个尺寸街的，上面是半透明的布，然后底下房子小小的，那个也给人感觉是很类似，因为我们走进去的时候，因为它尺寸的关系，因为那个是比较原来的用坐的躺的，那个。 公共的空间也是作为私有空间那个床铺的这个时候，人的关系比较接近于，当然不是车子的关系，也不是快的走了很大关系，而是非常亲密，几乎接近于榻榻米的，或者说很亲近那个私有的那个空间的，说这个部分。 以及在我们的很多类似像宝藏岩之类的哈，还有包括在一些就是旧的社区，然后他们后来又改建了这些空间里面，我们基本上都看到一个就是比较小的尺寸，然后空间之间互相交叠，但人的关系非常密切的。这里面我不晓得就是那个何首。 他提到的那个就是说，我们这边有对空间有某种特殊的解决，是不是跟这种就是那个 一种叫做叫做亲密的尺寸，或者说在那个类似像那个宁夏夜市，就说这里面我们既然可以在个公共的那个街道上面，然后我们坐在那边之后，那个商店里面的以及那个走到那边，就是人它形成一个非常非常亲密的一个关系，就说某种亲密的关系在我们的城市，虽然经过某种现代主义的洗礼之后，这种亲密关系在我们城市中间还继续存在，就说这个是不是你所提到的那东西？因为刚才两位前辈就是说话的时候都用非常非常抽象的语言，其实我们说不定听不太懂。
就是馆长有没有特别？我先把馆长我看我是不是了解？我想馆长在讲的这个事情是在谈到东方跟西方城市实际上有蛮不一样的一点，就是对于公领域跟私领域的定义或边界在哪里。在亚洲城市，事实上这个边界是模糊，就好像在上面我们看到这三件作品像五十岚城的作品里头，一个小小房子外面平台，那已经似乎是一个公共空间了，可是你在那边可以做非常私密非常个人的动作，那这个边哪到底哪边是一条线切开公共跟私人，在亚洲似乎这条线是移动的，是不明确的。在西方的城市这条线似乎是非常清楚的，那也许就是这个公私之间的定义，或对于什么是公什么是私的定义，这个是在两种文化背景下是不一样。那这一点是不是请两位都稍微跟我们说一下？
I'm using that as the desired model, that you've blurred the boundaries between public and private. It's the envy of many Western cities to have a street life, to have that engagement and to those contributions to the public realm. And we don't do that very well. That's why we're looking here to see that how that happens. I also mentioned that it's a sustainable model, an environmental model,because Australia now has surpassed the US in terms of the built footprint of each inhabitant. And it's actually quite shocking. It's probably about 10 times the amount of space that an Asian person needs. And we can't sustain that anymore. It's unnecessary. So we're looking at that model in Asia of using the street, of not having kitchens,of having dinner boxes as both a very positive social model and a very positive sustainable model. So yes, we are envying that, and I'm talking about that of eating on the street, of being on that street and blurring those boundaries. The typical suburban house in the US is all about making more and more boundaries between the street and the front gate and the front yard and the front porch. And I think that's a terrible model that we've got to stop.
Thank you. Tan Sheng 老师是不是也可以跟我们就这点公领域跟私领域的边界，在你观察的东方跟西方城市的有没有什么差别，或是你怎么看这件事？
一番象徴的に思ったのはですね、台北の街を歩きますと、たくさんこう手で書いてビラが貼ってあるんです。一番面白かったのは、道に道路に椅子が置いてあって、どうぞ座ってくださいって。でヨーロッパやアメリカの都市へ行くと、個人が出すビラというのはまずない。あるのはポスターです。ポスターというのはちゃんとしたところで制作され、まあそれも許可されたものを貼ってるわけです。で台北で特にその非常にこういうビラとかですね、手で書いたものが、それは街に向けてこういろんなことを訴えてるわけです。ですから非常にその思ったのはですね、 それからあと一つ道からですね道にいろんなプライベートなものなんだけどちょっとパブリックにも役に立つようなものがこういろいろ出てる例えば緑がちょっとあったり先ほど言いましたどうぞ座ってくださいって書いた椅子が置いてあったりですね、まあ、あれはその家のおじいさんも、まあ、時々座ってるんじゃないかと思いますがなんかそういうですねヨーロッパで考えられないですよね街を歩くとそこに椅子があって座ってくださいって言ったらなんかそれはきっとなんか事件かあるいは前衛的な芸術かと思うんですそういうやはりアジアの人たちにはそのパブリックとプライベートの間の境っていうのは相当意識として曖昧になっているのではないかと思
います。あ、can I ask a question? I mean, to you about with your interest in street life and the resident restaurants and that vibrancy of street life, how do you see what's happening in the east of Taipei?With places like Xinyi and the new residential high-rise developments there, with no apparent street life or different street life, in my opinion, how do you view that, or anyone? Anyone Taiwanese, perhaps?
Okay.我个人当然是觉得新义计划是一个很糟糕的想法在新义计划里头看起来就是一切都很美好但是街道是非常无聊的我们在比较旧的台北市区你会可以走到骑楼下面你人跟人人跟街跟人跟屋子里的人跟屋子里的活动有非常频繁密切的一种互动关系当你到了新义计划区你必须要进到屋子里面你才可以感知到屋子就外面是跟里面是断离那种人跟街道跟里面这种非常亲密的那种视觉上不断的交换以及身体上比较接近的关系都被破坏掉那我觉得那是非常糟糕的模式那所以不过看起来我们的政府认为那是最棒的方法所以我很担心我们的未来
But I think that that is the Western model being applied very literally onto the cities
事实上是因为在我想在亚洲城市在过去的一百年是把西方城市当作一个模型在学习那是不是真的学到了西方城市的好处也不一定可是他们就是学回来了一套东西那这套东西回来事实上我觉得现在是差不多应该要来检验我们自己要用我们的生活跟我们的经验来检验这些事情
Throughout the whole half 1 hour, I just realized you kept talking about the real city. And one of the things I thought we were talking about, actually the cities and the streets above us on the third floor, which has to do with the transition of cities and the culture and streets. Ron and I, when we started the project, we thought maybe we could actually have bicycle riding around on the third floor of the exhibition.And maybe put a car in there, or maybe put some shops, because the museum says that it closes at 6 o'clock, so we thought possibly create a night market on the third floor. So all this speculation we tried to do, and some fail, some attempt, some succeed. So I'm just wondering from our two panelists, thinking, what are kind of the ideal streets that you've seen, for example, from the third floor exhibition last night?
I think that as opposed to talking about specific works, I think what is extraordinary about the work upstairs is the deep knowledge that's imbued by all of the practitioners that are there, that experiential, that knowledge of where they're from and where they exist and how they operate in that. And I would consider that sort of really bottom-up, hands-on level that I'm espousing, which I think is really important. And, you know, it touches on a lot of the issues that I admire, such as the everyday. And I think that the way these practitioners are operating is a really good model for the future. And I think they were well selected by you.
那个，因为时间关系，所以是不是藤森老师也可以就这个问题做一个简单回答，当做我们的一个结论？
はい。
一番期待していたのはですね、北朝鮮からの展示で、ミサイルが展示されるっていう話を聞いていて、大変期待したんですけども、どうも本当のミサイルではなかったようです。ただ絵はですね、本当にいろんなことを考えさせる絵でした。で、私がですね、割と北朝鮮の展示と違う意味でですね、非常に面白いと思ったのが作家の名前は知りませんけど、壁に穴が開けてあって、その向こうに円山ホテルがある作品が、あれがとても面白かった
です。藤森老师的跟我们刚刚提的，那我们第一个阶段的时间也正好到，所以我们在这里就谢谢藤森昭信老师以及森海守教授跟我们参与第一阶段。那我们第二阶段会直接接续下去，第二阶段再说，我们也许掌声谢谢两位老师。